Lord, our hearts are open before you, Father. And we didn't gather today just to hear Chris Green talk, but Lord, we gather today so that you can speak to us. So in this moment, Lord, Chris Green decreases, that you would increase. Holy Spirit, you really are our teacher. And so we open up our hearts to you so that you can speak beyond the words of Chris Green, so that you can speak beyond my explanations or interpretations and all of that. But Lord, I thank you for going deep into our hearts and opening up new revelation, new understanding about you. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, Lord. It's always so exciting to receive the word. It really is. Very exciting, especially when you go back to the foundational teachings of the word. And there's a lot of things that have been going on in church. And if you're like me, those of you who grew up in church or around church and church life, there's a lot of things that you probably heard said and done. And it happened for years. And you just kind of just go along with it, but you never really understand it for yourself. And so when you face trials in life and unanswered questions and riddles, they're called enigmas in Proverbs, which are riddles, unanswerable questions, then you really don't have much of a foundation to go back on to be able to have answers or to have understanding or peace to deal with what you're going through in life. It's very frustrating to know that you have a call of God on your life, but you don't really know how to get started in it, where to go with it. You hear certain phrases said in church all the time, pastors across the pulpit, all these cliches, but nothing ever really connects. And I was always the kind of person, I needed the dots to connect. And so church is full of a lot of dots. But very rarely was there someone that would come along and connect the dots so that it can get a picture out of this. Remember some of those coloring books that had the dots? And you draw from, you know, from one number to another, and once you connect the dots, you'd see the picture. And church is full of dots and numbers, but no one ever draws and connects it. And so that part of what's happening right now, I felt like the Lord wanted us to go back to the very foundational teachings of the faith so that the dots would begin to connect for you and me, so that this calling that you sense upon your life versus the things that are happening in your life would begin to, a picture could emerge out of this. And you say, what in the world does talking about my salvation have to do with what I'm going through? And it has everything to do with what you're going through. Because you and I must have peace and assurance about where we stand with God. And that's so important because the Lord said he would lead us by his peace. So if you're never really assured about this thing called salvation and your relationship with God, then when trials and turmoils and storm hits, then there isn't something that God could draw from to lead you with. Since he leads us by peace, what's the peace? It's not just a feeling of calmness that comes upon us. It's the assurance. It's the assurance of our relationship with God. And he leads us with that same assurance. Isn't that profoundly simple and yet so important? Thank you, Lord. That's why in our own families, in our own lives, in our own situations, if things are disconnected, messed up between us and our parents, it's very difficult when we face trials and tribulations in our life, because it's real hard when you never have had that dad to say, it's okay. You're doing good. I'm proud of you. So you spend a lot of your life trying to please, and you spend a lot of your life never really sure that you're doing a good job of anything. You spend a lot of time second guessing yourself. I would make this decision, but I don't know. And that's because when we were real little, 2 and 3 and 4 years old, 5 and 6, in those important adolescent years, in those teenage years, there was never that strong adult that says, we're okay, I'm proud of you. You're my girl, you're my boy. when you've got that kind of assurance, that's what you see in some other adults, in some other children. They've got that kind of confidence. They've got that kind of confidence. You wonder, wow, why are some people so confident? And I guarantee you, you could trace it back to there was some parent or grandparent or somebody that patted them on the back and always assured them, we're okay. I love you. Don't make no difference how bad a game you had, how bad your grades were. I love you. I'm proud of you. Isn't that something? And so God wants us to have that. I feel his presence today. He wants us to have that same kind of assurance that even when we mess up, that I love you. I'm proud of you. No, I'm not proud of what you did, but I'm still proud of you. I love you. I don't love what you did, but I love you. And so the church has done such a horrible job of helping us, of us really grasping that concept about God, that even though he hates sin, God loves the sinner. And even when we give our lives to him and we mess up or we make bad choices and bad decisions, and sometimes we just flat outright rebel against him, but it never changes the fact that he loves us. Wow. Woo, aren't you glad? Come on, give the Lord praise for that this morning. Thank you, Lord. So that's why everyone said, Pastor Chris, why are we going through all these lessons on salvation and stuff? Because God wants us assured deep, deep, deep inside that he's right there, that he meant it when he said, I will never leave you or forsake you. And instantly in our minds we go, but what if I do? But what if I say? And nowhere in his scripture does he have, except for when, I will never leave you or forsake you, except, there is no except, there is no parentheses, there is no clause, extra clause, there's no fine print. And we didn't have so much stuff like that in our lives, so much fine print. We signed the contract, and then you find out later, this ain't what you told me it was. And sometimes we feel that way about even being in the family of God, because they preached the message and they told us, give our hearts to the Lord, commit to him. And then after we joined their church, then somehow all the rules change. What happened to all this loving, wonderful God that y'all preached about? And now every week, ever since I got here, it's been all about, I'm supposed to be living perfect and I'm supposed to be holy. And every time I do something wrong, I need to come back here and get saved all over again. So what happened to all this wonderful, loving, kind, gentle, all forgiving, unconditional love God that you told me about? Why did it switch after I got saved? And that's because what often gets preached and taught afterwards is tradition. We don't go back to what the Bible actually said. It's very, very easy. And so a lot of us, we got saved. We came into a church that had already been going 25, 30, 50 years. Sometimes people join churches that have been around for over 100 years. And so certain traditions have been passed on. Certain teachings have been passed on for years. And you think with your little self, you just walked up in there, you're going to change all of this? And you usually hear things like when you're young in the Lord and God's doing great things in you, and people kind of just look at you and it's almost like they pat you on the head like, yeah, just keep on living. You'll find out what it's really like. I know you're excited about the Lord right now, but you just wait till you go through a few things. You're going to be like the rest of us. I'm so thankful. I gave my heart to the Lord when I was 4 years old. And I'm 52 years old now. So it's been 48 years. And I'm still just as excited now as I was back then. Why? Because the Lord blessed me with parents that taught us right from the beginning that Jesus said, I'll never leave you or forsake you. And when we messed up and when we did stuff wrong, my parents were careful to say things like, you gave your heart to the Lord, so you have to keep doing things that please God. They didn't say things like, I thought you were supposed to be saved. I thought you were supposed to be Christian. See, even parents have to reinforce the security. If as a parent you say to your child who is saved, who has given their heart to the Lord, I thought you were supposed to be saved, then that instills that instability and that insecurity. But when you say, no, don't act like that because you belong to the Lord now. Don't behave like that because you belong to the Lord now. See, that enforces your behavior was wrong, but your relationship is still the same. Come on, bless the Lord. Isn't that wonderful to know? Thank you, Lord. So we asked the first question we asked as we were going through this lesson was, how do I know that I'm saved or that I'm a Christian? And so we answered that question by telling you that the Bible says the Holy Spirit assures us in our hearts that Christ is truly there and that we are new. And we asked the question, do you have the witness or the assurance of the Holy Spirit that makes you sure? And then we gave you these assurance scriptures. And I won't go through all of this today. I'm just going to encourage you to go back and watch those videos. Here are the assurance scriptures. The Bible says this witness is given only to those who have received him. Have you received him? You go, yeah. It's given to those who are in Christ. It's given to those who are joined to the Lord. It's given to those who have repented and believed the gospel. Remember, we talked about repentance. We repent from our own way. We repent from sin. And we took the time to explain the difference between confessing sin and repentance of sin, because many people have confessed and they never repented. So confessing sins, that's only part of it. Confessing sins is different from repenting. Confession is a first step. You can go and say, I confess, I did this, I did that. You know, I can come and confess, and well, I cheated on you, Carol, I cheated on you. Keep coming back and confessing I cheated on you, but that ain't repentance. Keep coming confessing that I cheated. That's not repentance. Repentance is I left her. I'm not going back to her. That's if she'll take me back. Repentance is cut all that off and stop. Stop. That's repentance. Now I have turned away from that lifestyle and I'm turning to the Lord. So confession is only one part. You must repent and believe the gospel. Repent. Turn from your own way. The word repent literally means about face. Go the opposite way from which you were going and believe the gospel. Wow. I won't get started in that. I won't make it any further, but go back and watch these videos in particular. This assurance is given to those who have been born again. This assurance is given to those who have confessed Jesus is Lord. This assurance is given to those who have believed and received him by faith. Very, very important. And it's also in your lessons there. And we'll answer questions at the end. Once you and I made the decision to give our lives to Christ, the Spirit of Christ is the one who makes us new creatures. You'll see that in 2 Corinthians 5:17. And the Holy Spirit lives within us to help us learn how to live and grow. And Philippians 1:6 is the assurance of God's going to complete what he said he would do. In fact, let's look at those two scriptures. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. And what's he talking about? He's talking about the inner man, the old has passed away. And you say, well, why do I still got some of the same struggles and the issues that I have always had in my life? It's sort of like this. You can, if someone hands you some flowers, you cut some flowers and hand them to you, you still see the blossoms and the green leaves and all of that. But actually, that flower is dead. Why is it dead? Because it's been cut off. And you're going to slowly watch that thing die. That's why they eventually wilt and everything turns brown and falls apart. Why? Because it's been cut off from its source. That's what happened when you and I got saved. You have been cut off from sin. And so even though you still look like everything's still the same, no, you knew. You've been cut off, and you're going to slowly watch. In some areas, some people have had certain deliverances to come to them quickly. Some people have delivered from alcohol or drug addictions and all kinds of things immediately. Then there are others, and I don't know why. I can't explain why. Then there are others who've had to go through the process of getting off the addiction, pulled away from it. So there are certain habits that you and I have. You give your life to the Lord at 30-something years old, you've got a certain way that you think, a certain way that you process life. But now, the Spirit of God has come to live in you. A whole new kingdom mindset has been introduced. And now you got to learn this new way. And even though you've been cut off from those old ways, you still got those tendencies. It's like being, best example, how many people in here are right-handed? How many right-handed? How many left hands? Well, one left hand. This is what it's like. Now, because of whatever hand you are, that's just automatic to you to use that hand to do certain things. Now, what if a part of your salvation was God switching what hand you use? So it's kind of awkward to get used to using that other hand because it's just natural to always use that hand. That's what it's like. Anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. Old things have passed away. All things have become new. It's like God's having to make you use another hand that you're not accustomed to it. You're not accustomed to thinking that way and responding that way and acting that way. And so when crises hit, when things come up that you weren't expecting, then there's this tendency to do what you always used to do. And that's part of the reason why. In fact, not part, that's the main reason why he wants us in his word. Getting in his word, getting in his presence, that's what gets you more and more accustomed to moving with the Spirit and not just moving according to your thoughts. Moving with the Spirit and not just going with your emotions. Some people are emotion driven. Some people are very much intellectual driven. And so their automatic response is always to think things through. Or some people's automatic response is to respond in anger or with hurt. And they live their life based on how they feel or what they think. And then here's the Spirit of God introduced into your life. And he's got his own feelings and his own thoughts. And so now comes the getting accustomed to listen to the Lord first. Respond to God first. And so isn't God so wonderful that when we don't respond to him first, he doesn't kick us out the family? Because he knows that's a flower, that's an old flower that's still drying up, still wilting, still getting... Hope you remember that the rest of your life. There's all those right-handed people trying to get used to using the left hand. All the one left-hand person trying to get used to using the right hand. That's what it's like. It's awkward. It feels funny. It does. I won't lie to you. It does feel funny and awkward when you're first learning how to do this. But that's why it's been so important that we are in a ministry, in a church, where we learn the Word of God. Thank you, Lord, where we really learn how to respond to him in teaching. Bless the Lord. Here's the next scripture. Philippians 1:6 says, being confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. He who has begun a good work, he's going to complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. So that's our assurance. He started it. He's going to finish it. Thank the Lord. Aren't you glad for that today? Then we ask this second question. Oh, and this was an interesting one. How does God expect me to live now that I'm joined in this relationship with him? How does God expect me to live? Wow, it took us a while to get to this one. But before I answer that question, I wanted to present to us today some understanding about our salvation. Because there have been so many things that we have been taught, we have been exposed to in church, and sometimes these scriptures were used interchangeably, and there really wasn't or really hasn't been a really good, a thorough explanation as to these words. Anybody seen these words before? Justification, sanctification, glorification. You probably have heard heard pastors and preachers and ministers and evangelists and people saying all this kind of stuff, and it's like, what does all this mean? So I really want us to gain a better understanding of what it really means to be saved before I answer the question, how does God expect me to live? Two times here in Harrisburg, I've heard pastors ask, who wants to be saved? First time it happened a number of years ago, more than 20 years ago. And then he never really explained to the folks that he called up to be saved. The first time it happened, I watched a pastor, people were actually standing at the altar, and he went to each one and said, you just keep seeking. You just keep seeking. You just keep seeking. And of course, I was just outdone, because when somebody finally comes to the point where they're ready to commit their heart to the Lord, and you send them away with just keep seeking, what does that mean? That's why I'm here. I came to church today because I'm seeking. Now you're going to send me away and tell me to keep seeking? And that's because many people don't, unfortunately, many people, even in pastoral leadership, don't know how to lead a person into salvation. And so they tell people to do what they were told. I was told to keep seeking, so I'm just going to tell you to keep seeking. Because here's one of those things, some of you who may have grown up in certain denominations of the church, there's a lot of stuff that's kind of just left in this mystical realm. And it's sort of like this. You'll know when you know. We can't tell you how to get saved, but when you get saved, you'll know it. Some of y'all shaking your head because you've been exposed to that. And Pastor Chris is going to just tell you right now the reason why they told you that, and the reason why that's been perpetuated and passed down from one generation to another, is because they didn't know. They didn't know how to tell you how to get saved. So they just told you what they was told. You'll know it when it happens. No, it doesn't come down to you'll know it when it happens. You'll know it when you do what God says. Repent, believe, and receive. It's just that simple. But because many people hold on to the experience, they're waiting for you to have an experience. Once you feel God, once you feel His presence, then you'll know you're saved. No, there's an actual intentional decision involved here. Yeah, very important. Then most recently, a couple of weeks ago, there was a pastor who asked everyone in the congregation, while he was preaching his sermon, and he came near the end, he asked everybody that wanted to give their heart to the Lord to raise their hand. And I saw several people lifting their hands. I'm one of those people that peeks. You know how they always say, bow your head. Bow your head, and those of you who want to give your head, heart to the Lord, raise your hand. So I peeked to see how many people in here wanted to. Y'all know y'all peeked too. You know you'd be opening your eyes to see who's.
I like that.
Because one of the reasons is you'd be wanting it, especially if you invited somebody to come, you want to see, are they really going to give their heart to the Lord? Or somebody, a co-worker, or somebody that you know, you'd be looking around to see if they're going to get saved today. So I peeked, and there were several people that had their hands up, and then the pastor proceeded to tell them that they need to live right. That you need to live right, you need to live saved, you need to live holy. Now those are things that need to happen, but let me kind of clarify that for you right now. Living saved and living holy and living clean is what people who have a relationship with the Lord do. That's not what you do to get the relationship. That's what you do after. Thank you, Lord. I preach on that one myself. Hallelujah. You know, it's sort of like in today's world, and I'm not condemning anybody that may have lived this way in part of your life. But it's sort of like a couple getting together and living together and saying, because we're living together, we're married. But you're not married because you're living together. even though we now have common law that makes it legal. So you're now considered to be married if you stay together 7 years. Some states it's like that. I don't know if it's like that here in Pennsylvania. But that if people want to live together, some states, if they're together 7 years or whatever that state may determine, then they consider you to be common law married, that you are married if because you stayed together that long. But that's not what the Bible says. Just because you're living together doesn't make you married. Living together is what married people do. And so people have that same concept with the things of God. Live right, be holy, live clean before the Lord, do all these stuff to be saved. No, that's what saved people do. And so this pastor started telling them all the things that saved people do, but he still didn't tell them how to get saved. And so that's why I'm kind of showing you this particular chart and kind of when I want to take the time to give you some explanation. First of all, we have to see our salvation in three phases, if you allow me to say it that way. We have to see it as something that has happened in the past, something that is presently happening to us, and something that will happen in the future. The Bible presents salvation in these three ways. First of all, we are delivered from, salvation is being delivered from the penalty of sin. That's first and foremost what salvation is. It's being delivered from the penalty of sin, set free from the penalty of sin. What's the penalty of sin? The Bible says that the wages or the payment for sin is death. And so when we are delivered, set free from the penalty of sin. In fact, Romans 3, verse 21, all the way to chapter 4, verses 12. I won't read all of that, but it says this. But now the righteousness of God, apart from the law, is revealed, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God, even through faith in Jesus Christ, to all and on all who believe, for there is no difference. Then the scripture that many of us are familiar with, verse 23, for all have sinned, and fall short of the glory of God. Some of you have heard that scripture before. Being justified freely, verse 24, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. What does that mean? We've been considered justified by his grace. So to be delivered from the penalty of sin, that is what it means to be justified. God considers that once you do that, that's a past. It's over. It's done. You are now justified. It doesn't mean that you weren't guilty, but it just means I have justified you. No, he's actually forgiven. He has forgiven you. He has pardoned you and me.
Another way of putting it is just as justified, I was just as if I hadn't sinned. Just yeah. As if I've never sinned. The penalty of sin has been taken away.
It's been taken away.
Justified, just as if I've never sinned.
One of the things that happened at the cross is Jesus was the Lamb. Remember how John referred to him? Behold the Lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world. And so what happened at the cross, I kept misstating this by saying Jesus Christ was separated from his Father. But actually, he was never separated from his Father. What happened was, because the word death means separated, that was the enemy's intention that Jesus would be separated from his Father. But what happened was, Jesus wasn't separated from his Father when he died. He separated sin from us. Woo! That's enough to preach and shout on the rest of your life. He did just what he said. I take away the sin of the world. So what the enemy thought, Satan and demons thought that they finally got Jesus into their realm of death. But the only thing that happened, because Jesus is God, and God can't be separated from himself, so what died? What actually got separated at the cross? Sin was separated from mankind. He took away the sin of the world. And when we receive, that's why it's important that we repent. What are we repenting? Repenting from my own way and turning away from sin. Then I'm turning to Jesus, to the Lord. and I'm receiving what was done on the cross. It was done for me. Woo, aren't you glad? That's what happened. It was done for me. You said, that's what happened when I got saved? That's what happened when you got saved. You have to understand, when we sometimes we even make this, we make the statement, get saved and then God will forgive you. No, he's already forgiven you. When you got saved, that's not when God forgave you. He already then forgave you. But he still leaves us with choice. Go all the way back to the beginning in Genesis. This was all, it's always been about choice. Giving man the choice. God gave man the choice to choose him or to choose his own way. Man chose his own way by disobeying God, eating of the tree. He disobeyed God. He chose his own way. But God says, I'm still going to make a way because I want my kids. But there has to be a way to pay for this disobedience. So God came himself. He sent Jesus, which was God in the flesh. He came, and when he died, he paid for the disobedience. He bridged the gap. Remember that chart that I showed you? That's what happened to us. So when we receive him, it's the choice again. It's back to that choice. Now I'm choosing. I'm choosing. We have to choose. We have to choose. We have to choose. That's really what it's about. We are choosing. It's always been about choice. God wanted people, God wanted a family. God wants kids. And he created us to be one with him, to be with him. He gave us this earth and said, take dominion. It's yours. But man in his disobedience gave it over to Satan and opened us all up to death and destruction and war and all the stuff that we see happening in the world today. So that's why people are tripping out. They're mad at God about all the stuff that has happened. But we brought it up on ourselves. We chose this. You said, but I wasn't even born yet. I didn't choose this. But we were in Adam when it happened. We were in the first man and woman. We were in them when they chose. So now that we've been birthed and we came into being in 1950-something or 40-something or 60 or 70, 80 or 1990-something, still we're just multi-generations later from a decision that was made way back then. And we came into a jacked up, messed up, toe-up world. But Jesus had already, he has already removed and separated sin. So all we have to do now is choose him. Back to that same thing. Back to choice. Because God didn't want us to love him because we have to. He wanted us to love him because we want to. Aren't you glad? Because we want to. I choose him. It's an intentional thing. And I'm saying this to you because there's a doctrine that's going forth in the world today called universalism that teaches when Jesus died on the cross, everybody was saved. And there's no longer a need to make a choice. Everybody's going to heaven. Everybody's going. And it's an extremely popular doctrine. And I'm telling you now, I'm telling you, mark my words, it's going to be probably the most influential doctrine to sweep this world. That it's all the same. We're all worshiping, even though we call God by different names, it's really all one. It's all one and the same, and everybody is going to experience a wonderful, glorious afterlife. No matter what your beliefs are, it's all the same. It's going to be a powerful, powerful, powerful sweeping movement in the world. It's going to be connected to one world government and new world order. I'm telling you now, it's all going to be connected. Because that's what it's going to take. I don't want to get off on that, but now you see why the choice is so important. Way back at the beginning, it was about choice, and all the way up to today, it's still about choice. I choose to repent, to believe, to receive. Isn't that wonderful? Come on, y'all, just take a moment just to receive that revelation in a fresh way. See, then it makes us all to understand why it was so important what I really did. I wasn't just joining a church. I wasn't just getting baptized in water. Even when we say, you know, maybe these words will become more powerful. Remember when somebody said to you, make a decision for Christ. Now see how important that decision was. You were making a decision about your eternity, my eternal soul. Now, where did the church or sometimes different denominations or teachings get off? They don't understand that justification is a past deal. It's over and done to God. That's over and done. He is no longer looking at you and me to determine if whether you are saved or not. You chose him. He came into you. Sin is erased. It's over. You are justified. So what about these other words that we sometimes hear, like sanctified and glorified? What does all that have to do with anything? Well, sanctification is about the process of being delivered from the power or the influence of sin. Because we still live in this world. And we still live in these mortal bodies. So even though I have been justified, I am still being sanctified, presently delivered from sin's influence in my life. Remember what I was talking about as I got started today, about that flower that gets cut off and you got this, all that stuff is dying. What's dying? That influence, that power, that way of thinking, that way of adjusting, processing life. That's what's dying. That's what's happening to me and you. Sanctification is a process. And so where people have gotten off, they think that when they find a believer who's still struggling or still in process, they tell them that they are no longer justified. So see where the mess up comes? You tell me that I'm no longer justified because I'm still being sanctified. But I am justified even while I'm in the process of being delivered from the power of sin. And depending upon my life, hold the questions to the end. And so depending upon my family, my upbringing, whatever generational iniquities are moving through my generations and in my family, though that determines what various influences and powers are dominant in my family and in my life, in my body. I know that for me personally, when it comes to maybe drinking alcohol or getting drunk and all that, that's not an issue for me. So it'd be easy for me to preach sermons on all the people about that. And that's because that was a generational iniquity that got broken in my father. Him, his brothers, his family, heavy drinkers. I have an uncle who died many years ago of the liver disease that you get from drinking. And so my dad was so determined. My dad was a smoker and a drinker. He was so determined. He did not want that passed on to his children, that he quit doing both while we were very small and never, ever exposed us to it in our home. So it was something that was broken. So that's not even an issue. Now, if for those who that is an issue, you was exposed to it, living around it, even parents and folks gave it to you while you was 2 and 3 years old, you was just opened up. So then when you got saved, it's a power. It's an influence that's strong because you were exposed to it and was introduced into your life at such an early age. That's why there are certain things that's not the same in every family. Now, I know that I picked up on, y'all probably won't believe this, but Pastor Chris used to have a violent temper, and it was passed on multi-generationally. Violent, y'all got a violent temper. Yeah, y'all, I was crazy. I could get so mad, I could kill, and I tried to. I tried to kill my sister. I threw a brick at her and was upset when I missed and went after her to finish the job by hand. Yes. Y'all shaking y'all heads like, I can't believe that you was like that. Yeah. And my dad had a very violent temper, and his dad had a very violent temper. So it was a struggle for me to control my temper. Woo, God. And some of you, that's in your family and in your line. And so you get upset with yourself when you lose your temper, but you're noticing that the more you stay in the Lord's presence and move in His will and in His way, that you don't get upset as quickly as you used to. Things that used to bother you, it takes a lot longer before you go off. Why? Because you're in the process of sanctification. And the times that you do go off and you say something you didn't say or do something you didn't do does not mean that you go back into being under the penalty of sin. Remember, the penalty of sin has been broken off of your life. What's the penalty? Death. Death is no longer over your life. Say that to yourself. Death is no longer over my life. Thank you, Lord. I will not be separated from God. That's what the word death means. It means separated. I will not be separated from God. But I just said this, and I just did this. He knows, but he knows that. That's why it was paid for. That's really hard for us to grasp. That's a tremendous revelation, but keep on hold, grabbing, wrestling with that. That even when I mess up, God, I'm still yours? Yes, because it's the past. See, you thinking of your sins and things that you're doing as being, is presently happening, and they're still in the future, but you have to understand God is an eternal God. And when Jesus died on the cross, you and I hadn't even been born yet. We hadn't done nothing yet, but yet the sin, the penalty was paid 2,000 years before we got here. So when God cancels our account, He doesn't mean I canceled your account all the way up until the day that you got saved. He's talking about even the stuff that you are yet to do. Now, this is the word really gets tough, because people hear that and they go, does that mean that I can live any old kind of way I want then if it's already paid for? Oh, no. We'll talk about this early, a little bit later, about there are still consequences to sin. You reap whatever you sow. If you sow to the flesh, you will of the flesh reap corruption. There are people who are doing these kind of things. I'll use sexual sin as an example. There are people who will go out and sleep around because they're like, well, I'm saved and the Lord's all, this is already covered by the blood. And then if they get some sexually transmitted disease or even HIV and AIDS, then, and I'm saying this because this has even been part of our family story. I have a brother, he died of AIDS. And I want you to hear me. He died of AIDS. And even though he came back into the family of God, I mean, not the family, came back to the church, came, got restored in his fellowship, he still died. And God's purpose that God had for him as part of our family was cut off. Why? Because there's still consequences for a believer that goes out and willfully disobeys God. You can miss out on your purpose. You can miss out on what God actually has planned for you in this life. Still go to heaven. Still go to heaven. Why? Why? Why are they still going to heaven? Because the penalty is paid. When a believer sins, then we opening up stuff to happen to us in our flesh. Notice what the Word of God says. When you sow to the flesh, you will what? Of the flesh reap corruption. I'll just use another very practical example. If you go into your job and you cuss out your boss, there's going to be some repercussions, and ain't no need of praying and asking the Lord, Lord, please let me keep this job. No. Now, you ain't going to hell because you walked into the job and cussed out your boss, but you're going to lose that job. And you're going to go through some financial turmoil and troubles and stuff that you could have avoided. That's what I'm talking about. So some of that stuff that we're still struggling with the power and the influence of sin and generational iniquities in our life, those are the things that cause a lot of our trials and a lot of our troubles in our life. It ain't even the devil. It ain't even the devil. There's stuff that we are still choosing to yield to. And then we reap the consequences of what we chose to yield to. Yeah. Now, here's the other danger. The more you keep yielding to it, you can actually come to a point where you start walking away from God. I'm not one of those preachers. I know that there are those who teach that once saved, you're always saved. I believe that a believer can come to a point where they actually say, I don't want this anymore. Even though it's rare, I believe it's a lot rarer than people, than even teachers and preachers talk about it. But you can come to a point where you do that. And where does that begin? It doesn't usually begin with some disappointment that happened in their life. It begins with a decision that they make. Starts off with a decision, something that they yield to, they give in to. It's always something very small. You just give in this time, and this time, and this time. Then the next thing you know, you don't feel like going to church. You don't feel like hearing the word. You don't really want to be around all this stuff anymore. Now you've opened yourself up for more of the power and that influence to come into your life. More and more stuff keeps happening. You keep sowing more bad seed, more stuff keeps happening to you. Now the enemy's got you all confused. Now you start blaming God for the things that are happening to you. And next thing you know, a person can actually come to the point where they say, I don't want God. I'm not talking about the person who just got maybe disappointed with the church. I think there are millions of people, not just thousands. I think there are millions of people who've been hurt at church, hurt by church people, and they don't go to church, but you ask them. If they walked away from God. And they'll say, oh, no, I ain't walked from God. I ain't going to church no more. I love God, but I'm not going to church ever again. I love God. I pray. I talk to him. I have a relationship with the Lord. And I believe that they do. Personally, I believe that most of them really do have a genuine relationship with the Lord, but they're suffering a whole bunch of stuff that they wouldn't have to suffer if they just go ahead and get in back tight with God. Because everyone in this room, you know, when you're in tight with God, he's able to speak to you. He's communing with you. There are certain things that you just begin to avoid. Why? Because he's speaking to you. He starts getting you ready for that boss or that crazy day that you're about to have at work. Because you're communing with him. He's letting you know. And we don't always listen to it. I know I don't. Pastor Chris, you don't know I don't. I'm the same as you. There are times I'm laying in the bed and I feel like the Lord be like, get up. Get up and pray. I'm like, Lord, I'm sleepy. I'm tired. And then you get to work and you just have the most miserable day all day long at work. And you know at the end of that day, if I had got up and prayed, that this would have went a whole lot smoother. Why? Because not only would he have been preparing my spirit to deal with this stuff, but he might have been able to give me an idea of how to even avoid most of it. Haven't you noticed that when you're in great communion with the Lord, you'll get to work and he'll say, do such and such, do it now. Don't wait till later, do it now. And you do it, and then the boss comes to you and asks you for the thing that you just did, and you'd be like, wow, God, you made me look good, because if I hadn't had that ready, this would have been a terrible day all day long. I would have been harassed all day long. That's what I'm saying. Isn't this great to know? And then eventually we will be delivered from the very presence of sin. And this is where a lot of us stay on this one in church, because we can't wait until the Lord comes and gets us out of here. And that's called glorification. So you can see, that's as far as I wanted to get into that today. Of dealing with the past tense, the present, and the future tense of salvation, and understanding what really happened to us, what's happening to us, and what's gonna happen to us. Woo! Aren't you glad today? Thank you, Lord. Come on, just take a moment. Let's be real intentional about this. Lord, I receive this. I receive this, Lord. I receive this understanding, this better understanding of really what you have done for me, what you are doing in me, and what is even yet to come. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.